This is a review of Undertale. Undertale will be looked at from an unbiased point of view, with my thoughts before and after I play the game. This review will contain vulgarity, spoilers, and flashing images. You have been warned. Before I played Undertale, I couldn't help but feel left out. Everyone and their mother was playing a game and praising it for its inventiveness and creativity. While most people would take that as a sign to play the game, I thought differently. I thought that the Undertale community was just hyping it up to get more people to play it, that they were claiming such outlandish things to make the game more interesting and worthwhile than it actually is. This is an effect I like to call Psychonauts Syndrome, where fans praise the game way too much while ignoring all of its problems. Not to say that it's a bad game, but it's not as good as the fanbase claims it to be. I've fallen into this proverbial hole before. At the end of it, the game leaves a bad taste in your mouth, and you don't like it as much as you thought you would. This has happened to me before with games like Psychonauts, obviously, Telltale's The Walking Dead, and Half-Life 2. And I did not want to repeat the same mistake again. But after much deliberation and thought, I decided to give it a try. And after starting the game, narrowly avoiding death, solving the easiest puzzles, and fighting a ridiculous amount of monsters, did I come to the conclusion? The game was not that good. Don't get me wrong when I say it, the game is good, absolutely immersive even, but the hype train that persisted long before and after the game came out has brought such high expectations that nothing the game could do would ever match them. Most people praise the game for its gameplay, aesthetic, and its story. However, I will be criticizing all these points to the best of my abilities without having any personal bias coming into the video. So, let's start off with the easiest topic then. The gameplay of Undertale is fairly unique. As opposed to most JRPGs where you enter a fight and have to kill all of your opposing enemies, in this game you can convince them to stop attacking you, without having to raise your weapon. In order to do this, you have to use the ACT command, where you are given a large assortment of options to interact with the monster of your choosing. Some of these options will calm the monster down and allow you to spare them, while the other options will do diddly jack shit. In some cases, after using the right ACT method, you can catch some green objects on the screen. These will heal you, but you still have to be careful as you can still get hurt by the monster's attacks. Talking about the attack screen, let's go on to how interesting it is. In most JRPGs, you were forced to take damage from your opponent if you weren't able to kill them. In Undertale, however, you can move a heart around the screen which can dodge attacks and obstacles that are thrown at it. If it gets hit by something, you will lose a percentage of your health. But be careful, if there is more than one monster engaging you, they can both attack you and clutter up the combat area, leaving less space for you to move around and increase the likelihood of you getting hit. And as in any game, if you lose all of your health, game over. And if you wanted to fight back, you choose fight and try to get your attack bar as close to the center of the screen as possible for maximum damage. And with some weapons in the game, you'll have multiple bars to centralize. The more bars closer to the center, the more damage. Now, most people would claim that this gameplay is absolutely genius and astounding. However, I think they're only looking at it from the ACT point of view. The combat is rather lackluster, and after fighting or pacifying a couple of monsters, the combat area just becomes redundant. Once you know how a monster attacks, they don't really change up their style and become easy to avoid when you know what they're doing. Speaking of monsters attacking, didn't anybody at all find it odd that these total strangers are just attacking you for no reason? Now, I've read theories that they're simply using magic to interact with you, but that only leaves a question as to why are the other monsters not attacking you. You walk through a town, a small village, and a hotel without having any of the monsters there attacking you, so why is this bunch drastically different from all the other monsters in the safe havens? Oh well, that's not going to be answered, so let's move on to the next subject of this review. This is probably going to be the shortest part of the review. The look of a game can vary to many people. To some, they want absolutely astounding visuals and photorealistic environments. To others, the visual style of the game doesn't matter to them as long as it's appealing. And if you couldn't tell, Undertale doesn't exactly have the most advanced graphics. And that's okay, the game uses this pixelated art style very well, though it's a hit or miss at times. At times it feels like the way the character was modeled was made to fit a scene that it's in, and other times it feels completely off. In this footage of the game, I murdered Metaton, and Alphys looks like she's smiling at me even though I just killed her friend. In contrast to that, however, you have scenes like your first time meeting Asgore. His sprite looks like it was made specifically for this cutscene. Even when he's looking outside the window to admire the day, it looks like he's truly appreciating it. However, the sprites and animations can become a bit stupid thanks to the game's jokes. Animations where Papyrus is literally flying around the screen and Flowey getting blown away are sort of jarring. It breaks the atmosphere's tone. The game can have serious moments, but if you're trying to be serious, maybe leave out the funny moments for some other time, because they ruin the entire point of a serious scene. Well, on to the next topic, which will be covered greatly and more than likely end up with my neck in a noose. Let's move on to the story. The story begins with Frisk falling into a mountain and not sustaining any injuries because he fell into a patch of flowers. So we're not going for realism points here. Frisk then walks down a corridor to meet Flowey, the worst character I have ever had the pleasure of knowing. Not because he's annoying, insults the player, or even tries to kill you, but for the simple fact that he has a conflict of interest that the whole story depends on. Flowey says that he can't feel any emotions, that he can't feel sad, happy, fear, anger. The game relies on the fact that he can't feel emotions. The story pivots around this one character trope, but when you're facing him off, when you're annoying him to no end, he shows such emotion, such contempt and anger at your actions. So that's one broken piece of the story to deal with. Moving on, you get to meet Toriel, your surrogate mother, who tells you to never harm anyone and always try to find the peaceful solution. Anyway, she leads you through some of the puzzles in the ruins, but not before watching you kill a frog and saying absolutely nothing after telling you to never harm anyone, does she decide to leave you in the ruins to make special pie for you instead of just bringing you home. No wonder her child died. After walking through the rest of the ruins and killing whatever monster tries to brutally murder you in cold blood, we make our way to Toriel's home, which is an exact replica of the original home. Or is it the other way around? Either way, after being persistent about leaving, you have to fight her for your right to leave her home, after which she gives you a hug and sends you on your way, but not before banishing you from ever setting foot in her house again, like a good mother would do. And soon, we are on our way to meet everyone's favorite comic relief character, Sans, who is about as funny as a dying goat. Which we then get to meet his overzealous brother Papyrus, who dreams of capturing a human so he can become popular, because handing over a child to a murderous king is sure to win you some cool points. Though if you're a hardcore fan, you're probably saying,
they would be happy because it's a human that he's turning in, and they hate humans.
Well, that's where I'm going to stop you, because every monster in the underground doesn't even realize that Frisk is a human. So, they utterly hate humans with every fiber of their being, yet they don't even know what they look like. Papyrus makes you go through a bunch of his puzzles because capturing you outright wouldn't be in the spirit of things, even though you only need one human soul to get out of the underground and live on the surface, but I guess fun in games ranks higher than liberating your entire species. After dealing with Papyrus' puzzles and finding out Sans can just do things, we set foot in a little town called Snowden. I guess they're a little too snowed in to come up with a better name. The town consists of all sorts of monsters who don't attack Frisk outright because they're decent people who aren't looking to kill random strangers out in the woods just because. But walking past all that, we get into our fight with Papyrus, which as you can imagine is pretty easy and makes me question how anybody can take him under their tutelage if all you have to do is stand there and wait for him to say,
"Let's be friends!"
Moving on, you come into the next part of the game called Waterfall. This is a major part of the game where lore is, how monsters wish to come back up to the surface and stop wallowing down here. The only question I have is, why do they want to go back up? I don't see why they hate it down here. Yes, humans have forced them to go into the depths of the earth, but is there really anything that's making life miserable? We just saw a thriving town in the middle of a snowy forest. I don't think they're struggling.
Whatever, that's not going to be answered.
It's at this point that we see Undyne, the captain of the Royal Guard, a hardened piranha who doesn't at all let their emotions get to their head. On that note of the Royal Guard, where is it?
I only count, like, what, 6 people? And Papyrus doesn't count because he's still in training. If this is what their army consists of, then no wonder they lost the war. But even if they had bigger numbers, I doubt Undyne would be the best choice to lead them. She's easily distracted, wayward, and unfocused, a reflection of how smart Asgore is. Near the end of the pacifist storyline, Toriel will tell Asgore how much of an idiot he is for not taking one soul and going through the barrier to get the souls they need, making Asgore seem like such a dumbass, but it just raises the question as to why Toriel didn't tell him this before instead of just waiting for the perfect moment to barge in like a dramatic soap opera. The story has plot holes that, while avoidable, really breaks your sense of disbelief when you think about it more carefully, though you won't really notice them unless you truly think about the game's mechanics like I have, but we are getting ahead of ourselves, let's get back on track. The next part after meeting Undyne, we fight a dummy, pass through yet another town, meet Tem, and walk through a bunch of flowers that turn off somehow. Then we finally fight Undyne for the first, second, third time.
And depending on how you play this section, you either run the fuck away or bear witness to one of the saddest parts of the game.
Next up, we manage to go into Hotland, where pools of lava are just everywhere and there seem to be no guardrails for some reason. It's at this point we meet Alphys, a reptilian-like creature who likes to stalk Frisk because anime. That is literally the reason. She's a reflection of the nerdy girl who does nerdy stuff with the nerdiest of nerdy anime.
Which makes me question, how the hell did she get anime down here in the first place?
From viewing these images, it looks like the humans banned monsters down here during the Middle Ages, and I'm sure as shit they didn't have hentai back then. But I digress. As you're talking to her, this robot comes out of the wall and makes you take a quiz, threatening to kill you if you don't. Take the quiz, select the answer Alphys says with her hands, and then leave the room. Then comes the annoying part of Alphys, who keeps updating her status again and again. And again, and again. I hated this part of the game. I get the fact that they're trying to break the tension and put in some form of humor, but the tension has already been thrown out of the window and tossed into a garbage fire. There's really no reason to have this in here. But let me get this straight. I'm talking about the text messages, not the times when she calls you. I find those to be fine. But I get sick of hearing this grating sound every single time I'm trying to progress. But moving on, from Hotland, defusing bombs, killing a spider boss that was literally just thrown in, making a cake, possibly killing 2 guards, listening to some shitty fanfic draft, and guessing your way around this minefield-looking thing, you finally make it to a hotel. Sans will ask you to go into the restaurant next door and give you more lore before rightfully making you question why you're friends with him. More gags ensue and move the fuck on. Making your way across the core, as it's been so cleverly named, you begin to edge your way to New Home to fight Asgore. But not before you get lost in this hedge maze of a building to turn off 2 switches that have lasers that are conveniently blocking your way to New Home. I swear, if this elevator system ever broke, how would Asgore ever talk to his people? Getting past the lasers and making your way across a bridge, you finally come to the door you need to open.
Ah, fuck, why is there a save point here?
Going through the door, you fight the robot that's been in a pain in your ass ever since you stepped foot in Hotland. Finally, to reveal that the robot is following Alphys' orders. Shocking, I know, it's almost like I didn't have enough time to build a meaningful relationship or character development with her constant updates. Fight him long enough, and then he becomes Handsome Squidward 2.0. Kill him or don't, move past him, and then Alphys will drop the big bomb of you have to kill Asgore to leave this place. Which, depending on how you got to this point, really doesn't matter.
Because he's gonna die anyways.
Either way, you're going to kill him or spare him for the neutral route. But anyways, taking the long elevator ride up, walking past the colorful ass scenery, you walk into a replica of Toriel's home. And as you clearly can't climb over, go under, or go around the advanced security system, you need to look into the house for 2 keys. But while doing this, you have lore literally thrown into your face without any rhyme or reason. I know that Toby was trying to have the whole story out there, but there is a difference between letting the audience learn about the lore and making them. If Toby really wanted to have players read more about the world, maybe make a book stand out amongst all the gray scenery. I mean, shit, you did that with the flowers and presents. And soon after having lore shoved down your throat, you come into a cathedral-like hall with Sans standing in your way to tell you about the intricacies of EXP and love, which stand for Execution Points and Level of Violence. You'd think Sans would make me pay for killing more than a couple of monsters, but he just doesn't care. Until he does. But that's for later. Keep moving forward, meet Asgore, realize he's a softie, and prepare to kill him with all the full force and willpower of determination as you sharpen your knife. But before you do that, go back and take a ride instead. Walk down the stairs and realize that they've already got your name written down on a coffin. Why and how he managed to get my name is still a mystery to me, and also makes me realize he's one cocky motherfucker if he thinks I'm going to die that easily. Go back to Asgore and get ready to fight. As the fight initiates, Asgore pulls out his trident and shatters Mercy. I thought this was a nice touch to show to the player that Mercy is not an option and that you have to fight to win. The boss battle is rather easy and only requires some memorization. After fighting Asgore, you are given the option to kill or spare him. Either option will still end up with him dead because Flowey will pop up out of nowhere and kill him. While you were fighting Asgore, Flowey was busy absorbing the 6 human souls, and now you gotta fight Photoshop Flowey, the true final boss of the 3 final bosses. This is where the game's difficulty ramps up. Depending on how good you are at the game, you can easily beat this boss within a couple of deaths, but if you're like me and just binged the whole game out at 2 in the morning when you first got it, then you probably died a lot. Anyways, as it turns out, these souls that Flowey absorbed have their own little world, each world showing Frisk how they originally were. Every world is different from one another due to how they attack Frisk, either by using a gun, pan, ballerina shoes, etc. The point here being that you can find the same weapons throughout the game, more or less putting a marker on how far each human managed to make it before kicking the bucket. Small detail, but I liked it all the same. But after dealing with the Hearts' worlds and they somehow managing to fight against Flowey's control, you've finally beaten the game and are given the option to kill Flowey or give him Mercy. Either way, the game ends and you'll get a call from Sans telling you how everything down here has been since you've left. Depending on how many monsters you've killed and which of the main characters you've left alive, there's some variance between each of the regular endings, but they're all relatively the same. Afterwards, Flowey will pop up and tell you to play the game without killing anyone. So we're just gonna go on a genocide route instead. The genocide route sounds exactly as you would think it to be. You kill everyone, literally everyone. You do not discriminate to who you kill. Everyone must die. And so they will. Insert killing montage here. One thing about the genocide route is that once you kill everyone in the ruins, a number will begin to appear when you save your game. This is a representation of how many people you have left to kill in that area, from the ruins to Snowden, Waterfall, and Hotland, all until you get a message with ominous music playing in the background. The way you get to the castle is more or less the same, just have to kill everyone. The only differences are that Sans will stop interacting with you and dialogue is for the most part changed. Puzzles are completed for you automatically as your only goal is to get to the castle. There are only 2 new boss fights, and both of them are a pain in the ass. The first boss you will fight is Undyne the Undyne, and the only way to get her is to attack Monster Kid, who she stands in front of to protect from your attack. And from just one hit, she's pretty much dead. But not before she pulls herself back together and to fight you. She's pretty much like the original Undyne, but her attacks do more damage, she's a ripe bitch and took me 3 hours to beat. And just so you know, I got most of the footage in one day, so I really was fucking tired. After beating her, you get to see her melt before turning into dust. Keep moving on and then realize that Alphys is gone, not there to introduce herself and give you godly phone. Turns out she was watching the fight and is evacuating everyone to safety. Except the monsters that didn't evacuate to safety. Push forward, kill all the monsters in Hotland, and then move on to fighting Metaton, which you kill in one hit. As you make your way past the gorgeous landscape of New Home, Flowey begins to tell you about his journey and placement of the lore that was supposed to be triggered. It all comes to a stop when he realizes that he's scared of you. Apparently, it's the first emotion he's felt in a long time, but I'm calling bullshit for reasons I've already discussed. He runs away, and before you can kill him in cold blood, you walk back into the cathedral-like hall to be stopped by Sans. This is the part where you regret making your decision. Sans attacks you with an overkill move in the beginning, and then your life will turn upside down. After he kills you, and he will kill you, he begins to mock you for dying to him, saying you have a look of someone who's died X amount of times. Sans attacks are constant and require full attention at all times. The way you lose health in this fight is different than what you're used to. Instead of taking off chunks of health and allowing you a grace period, he attacks you for every frame you're in his attacks. So if you're in his attacks for 1 second, there goes 1/3 of your health. This fight, while meant to be challenging, is complete bullshit. His beginning attacks are memorable, but when you get all later with his shit, he can do this crap. Might as well be throwing me against a wall with spikes coming out of the—
OH WAIT, HE DID THAT!
It is unfucking fair, and you will die. One of the times I got this fucking close, but guess what? He pushed me into the fucking laser! Oh well. Because of my determination, I got that far again, and I did kill him. Fuck this fight. I know I'm saying personal bias, but this fight is unfair. It is meant to be unfair. To make you reset the world, so to say. Next up, Flowey tells Asgore about all that's happened, and you kill him promptly, and then beat the shit out of Flowey for ever questioning your bloodlust. Now as to why Asgore never got the 6 human souls that he's in storage, I don't know. He never answers that. It's never brought up, it's never thought about. Why didn't he get the 6 human souls? He might have killed me. He does not know that I can respawn. Of course, it's not really you that pulls the trigger, but this smiling little prick. Because that makes sense. This little cunt is you. It's your name! It's the name you've selected for Frisk, because... why? I don't really know. I actually know that his canon name is Kara, but Toby decided to call him your name instead. I seriously don't know why. Either way, you end up with the choice to erase this world or not. Doesn't really matter. You die no matter what you choose. You start the world back up, and so begins the waiting game of 10 minutes. Before Kara asks you why you're there and why you care so much about this world. He comes up with a solution, however. At the cost of her soul, you can play this game again. Say yes and begin your path to the pacifist route. It's time to play Goody Two Shoes with everyone and play as a pushover. This part of the game is pretty much as it plays out in a normal playthrough. The only difference is instead of fighting off everyone that tries to kill you, you instead try to be their friend, despite the fact they're trying to kill you. I've already touched up on how this works in the gameplay segment, so I'm not going to talk about it here. The game plays out the same, except there are a few tidbits thrown in here and there. By sparing Papyrus, you will gain access to his house, and subsequently his room, where you go on a date with him. And despite my best efforts, we still became friends. Moving on to Undyne. You spare her, run away, and give her water, which activates her part of the pacifist route. Keep moving forward until you fight Metaton, and during this fight, you're gonna want to use the act to build up ratings at the top left corner. Build up those ratings until they're 10,000, and then you'll be done with the fight. But that only makes me question why Metaton would want to become a robot at all. He is a ghost, and I'm more than certain that ghosts can just change their shape because they're, you know, ghosts. And not only that, but he can't get hurt either. If you fought Napsabluk until the end of the battle, he'll tell you that you actually can't kill him since he's already a ghost, but in that same light, he can hurt you all he wants. If Metaton really wanted to go back to the surface, why didn't he just abandon the body he was in and just fight you that way? Whatever. Anyways, move on, fight Asgore, realize that you need to go back and do some friend quests for Piranha Girl. So go do that. Go to Undyne before fighting Asgore and get to know her. Papyrus introduces the two of you to each other before throwing himself out a window. She still hates you for not fighting back, and as a token way to make you pay, she decides to be the best host ever. By throwing a spear at you, limiting your choice of beverages, and making you burn her house down. And then you two are best mates! She goes back to Snowdon, and you have to go back there too to complete your last couple of quests. She gives you a letter in which you have to deliver to Alphys because Undyne is just that incompetent to tell Malman to do it. Deliver the letter and subsequently get confused for having a crush on Alphys because I totally want to tap that reptile ass. Do I look like Enigma to you? Go to the garbage depot to dump the body of the soon-to-be-dead. Change your plans when Undyne comes on screen. They talk a lot about Undyne having the actual feelings for Alphys and that Frisk is just the messenger. Alphys gets dunked on and thrown out to where she belongs, and then crush Undyne's dreams as you tell her that anime is not real. You thought you were done? Think again! You get a call from Papyrus that Alphys needs your help based on a feeling. Go to her home, realize that she's not there. Click on everything and then go down this elevator shaft that was disguised as a bathroom. Then panic as the elevator starts to barrel its way down. Read up some more lore and then meet some of the most mutilated monsters this game could come up with. Now at this point, you can kill the monsters or don't. You're locked in the pacifist route either way, so whatever. Go around the facility, deal with whatever monsters are here, and restore the power to the area. In order to restore the power, you must go around a field and collect these little orbs and put them back into their proper place. How they manage to get out is beyond my comprehension. After doing that, you flip the switch to activate the power and then Alphys comes in to save the day by promising to give these things food. Apparently, she's been trying to turn the power back on, but she just failed to do that. The more important question is, how doesn't she even know how the power works? She unloads her feelings onto you about how scared she is to not come back, and after all that she's done to these guys, she might have to tell the truth. But this review's long enough, so let's just skip to the end. After leaving the laboratory and going to Asgore, Toriel comes in, insert soap opera joke here. Then all of your friends come to say, stop fighting, and just before you're all about to have a huge and wonderful orgy, Flowey MacGuffin comes in and ruins it all. He hasn't at all learned his lessons with the human souls and already absorbed them all. But just as he's about to kill you, your friends protect you from his attacks. Then all the monsters you've encountered show up and start to help you as well. And just as you think you're about to beat Flowey with the power of friendship, he turns the tables around and absorbs the souls of everyone there, monsters included. Minus you, of course. This is where the worst part of the game comes in. This is the final boss of the pacifist run and is thought of as the final boss of the true ending. And for such a momentous occasion, Toby made the boss way too fucking easy. The moveset is so easy to remember, dodging his attacks is a joke, and you can spawn in healing items during a fight if you choose the dream option. If you manage to die, you literally can't. You cannot die, it refuses to die. And you continue where you left off. And then he goes Dragon Ball Z and goes into his final form, where his attacks are even less powerful. Don't worry though, you can still manage to bullshit your way out by reaching out to your friend's souls who are still in Asriel. Make them realize it's you they're fighting and then Asriel is sorry, and then hug him. Or don't. I didn't. Everyone is allowed to go to the surface and happily ever after. Except Flowey. I guess he just wants to stay down there.
So, what do I think about the story? Meh. I don't really have any strong opinions about it. I think the story is fine. Fine. Not spectacular. There are glaring problems and plot holes that just remain stagnant in the era and aren't addressed at all, such as Flowey's emotions. Yes, I get the fact that he feels fear near the end of the genocide route is supposed to show how your character is terrifying, but does that mean Flowey wasn't really trying to feel anything? That's another problem. Toriel not telling Asgore about going up to the surface with one human soul is another huge plot hole. Her arrogance to do that simple thing actually led to the death of more humans than whatever could have happened before. That's never talked about. Papyrus' list of priorities is all over the place with Undynes and Sans, who decided only to care if you kill enough monsters, even though you can kill every monster and leave only one alive at the end. It's just really stupid. Even Kara's hatred for humans isn't brought up. Oh yeah, Kara, that guy that just sort of showed up, actually hates humans. The guy at the end of the genocide route who killed everyone, both monsters and humans, without any rhyme or reason, even though the monsters under the underground were basically treating him like family, and he decided to kill them all. For some reason. They don't talk about that. Ever. Those, however, are the only downsides to the story. The idea that there once was a human that was considered a son to the royal family is an interesting idea, even if it has been done to death. The integration of dark themes mixing with the colorful world is actually done pretty well for the most part. The idea that this bright world has such a dark undertone to it is actually beautifully executed. But that's world building. The world of Undertale is almost magical, only being held back by the mediocre story. Toby, if for some reason you're watching this, please know you should probably hire a professional editor slash proofreader to look for these sort of things. They can really enhance the story into a higher quality.
Should you still buy the game?
Yeah.
Should you expect top tier anything?
No. The game was developed by a small group of people and it shows. The only real positives are the world building and the fact that your meddling will carry over to other playthroughs of the game. Because the game is aware of what you're doing. It doesn't expand it at all, but it gives it this look of ingenious that it doesn't really deserve, as it more or less blocks out whatever negative effect the story has. And yes, I did leave that out to the very end because it overshadows most of everything the story has to offer in terms of quality, and any game, movie, or franchise should not be forgiven for its flaws because of one trait. Still doesn't affect the entirety of the game, nor how much I enjoyed it. I think this is the end of the video now. I know it's a lot different than my usual content, and if you've managed to make it all the way to the end, I would like to thank you for listening to me rant about a game that I think is okay. But either way, thank you for watching. If you liked what you saw here, then be sure to leave a like on the video and comment down below to let me know what you think. If you'd like to see more of this stuff, feel free to subscribe to me. I might make more videos like this in the future. Until then, have a good day, you invisible faces.